Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, come on and worship God on today. You know, we magnify God because he is the true and living King. And I am your host, Pastor Alyssa Narvaez, and this is Alyssa Narvaez Ministries. I just thank God for each and every one of the viewers and listeners out there on today. I thank God because we are going to the book of Romans. Hallelujah, Jesus. And as we go to the book of Romans, let us first go to the throne of grace with prayer. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. We magnify you on today, God, for being the true and living King. We glorify you, Heavenly Father, for, oh, Bashata, Son of God, you are the am that I am. And when you said that you were the am that I am, you settled the matter at that time, Heavenly Father. And so we look for you to settle the matter of the issue on today, Heavenly Father. We invite you into the midst of the service on today, Heavenly Father. We ask that you would move by your glorious spirit. And God wanted me to let you know on today that he does settle the matter of it all. And as we go to the throne, hallelujah, God, of the book of Romans, we just lift God up on today and we tell God thank you and amen. You know, God is a mighty God that we serve. What a better place that we would like to be than in the presence of the true and living King. Hallelujah. If you have your Bibles, let's go to Romans. Oh, Bashata, Son of God. The Bible declares in the book of Romans, you know, the book of Romans, hallelujah, was a book, amen, issued to, hallelujah, God Jesus, to the Romans. Hallelujah, God, issued by Paul. Amen. He was in Corinth, amen, but circumstances prevented him from going further. So instead of a personal visit, Paul explained the things he would like to otherwise have told in person. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. So have you ever been in a place in a time in your life when it seemed as though, hallelujah, God, Jesus, you just wanted to write a letter. Hallelujah, God. And when in that letter that you wrote, amen, you may have written down all the things that were important to you. Have you ever written a note to your children or a loved one, amen, and you wanted to let them know, give them instructions on what to do while you were not in their presence, amen. And so this is what we find that Paul did, amen, to the church, amen, in Rome. He wrote to them, amen, about how they should conduct themselves and how they would look to Christ Jesus as the author and the finisher of their faith, and how that they would look to Jesus as the heir of their salvation. Amen. When Paul was not, amen, with them. Hallelujah. I thank God for this teaching series on today. Amen. As we go to the book of Romans for the teaching series. Hallelujah. God, the first chapter of Rome goes to read. It says, Paul, a servant. Hallelujah, God. And if I were to pause right there by the unction of the Holy Ghost, it says, Paul, a servant. Amen. How many of us know that we are servants in Jesus Christ? Amen. Everything that you do, hallelujah, whether you're on your job or you're with your children or your family or your husband or your wives, amen, you are a servant. Hallelujah, God. But first and foremost, we have to be a servant to King Jesus. For how can we know to be a servant to our family and loved ones if we don't first serve Jesus Christ? Amen. I once heard, hallelujah, a man say, amen, that you are dedicated by the servitude that you give to Jesus Christ. Amen. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. Amen. How many of you know that you have been separated on today? Amen. God says that he separates us. Move, Holy Ghost, by your spirit. He separates us from amongst the crowd. Amen. This is why we are called, oh, Bashata Sunday, holy. God said to be holy. Amen. And to be holy, that means that we have been separated for the use of God's service. Hallelujah, Jesus. For it is through the sanctification process that God makes us holy. Oh, Bashata, Son of God. And God is definitely separating us from some things on the day. And God is going to settle the matter of all that you're going through. Hallelujah, God, Jesus. And so we find here that Paul wrote to the Romans and he said, separated unto the gospel of God. Isn't it important to know that Paul identified who he was from the very beginning? And it is important that we be able to identify who we are. Amen. I am able to identify who I am in Christ. You should be able to identify who you are in Christ as well. If you were to place yourself amongst all the other pawns on the chess table, would you be able to identify as one that was different from the rest? Oh, Bashata, Son of God. The Bible says, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Oh, Bashata, Son of God. And if God were to take us on a little joy ride on today, he would say that the book of Romans was a book that was written by Paul to the people in Rome. And God is writing a book about your life. And the author of the book is Jesus Christ. And the reader of the pages is you and the ones that you know. And God took Paul, by the way, and he wrote a story for Paul. And he called the story good and done, thou faithful servant. Oh, well done, thou faithful servant. You know, Paul was a man that said, I press towards the mark of the high calling which is in Christ Jesus. And this is about the letter that God is writing. For God is letting you know on a day that he's writing a letter on your behalf. He's writing a letter on your behalf that's telling you to let the people know on today that you are somebody in Christ Jesus and that God is settling the matters of your issues in your life. God said he settles the matter. This is why they say amen. You know, the word amen is a word that's used to indicate the end of something. To say amen is like putting a period at the end of a sentence. And God sent the preacher by to let you know today that as we go through the book of Romans, oh, Bashata, Son of God, the book of Romans is writing a letter for Paul. It is on behalf of the Holy Spirit that the letter is being written on behalf of Paul. And God is writing a letter in your life. For the Bible declares that the letter says concerning his son, Jesus, Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. See, you gotta know first and foremost, when you get to write the letter of your life, you gotta address it to the right individual. This is why you gotta let the enemy know, if God be for me, then who can be against me? This is why you gotta let the enemy know that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. That's according to Philippians 4:13. You gotta let the enemy know, according to Romans 8:28, that all things work together for the good of me that loves God, for the good of God's people. Everything that I'm going through on today, it's working together for my good. Why? Because I was called according to God's purpose. See, God has purposed you on today, and God has purposed me on today. Just as God purposed Paul, Paul wrote the letter, and Paul addressed the letter to a certain group of individuals. And God is writing the letter for your life on today, and he's addressing it to all your enemies on today, and he's letting your enemies know that they are your footstool. He's letting your enemies know that you can do it and you're going to make it. Somebody ought to tell themselves, I'm going to make it through this struggle. I'm going to make it through this issue. I'm going to make it through all that I'm going through. Whatever you're going through on your life on today, you are going to make it. If God has to send out a letter and address it to all of those that need to know, just as Paul addressed the letter to those that needed to know, see, this is what you need to do when I'm not in your presence, is just read the letter. And God is saying, when you feel as though I'm not close by, just read the letter. If I did it before, I'll do it again. For I'm the Alpha and the Omega. I'm the beginning and the end. And I'm not a man that I should lie, nor the son of man that I should repent. If God said he was going to do it, all you got to do is believe in the letter. What does the letter say? Well, I'll tell you what the letter says. The Bible said, and the Son of David declared to be the Son of God with power and all according to the Spirit of the holiness by the resurrection from the dead. And there you go right there. See, it doesn't take a whole lot to know what God is saying. God is saying that according to the resurrection of the dead, oh, my Son of God, and according to the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit that lives in the earth, in you and in me, that the resurrection of the dead things in your life, all the things that you're going through, all the things that seem to be stopped in the middle of the track. Have you ever been at a place in your life when somebody cooked a good meal and all of a sudden they said, come and get it? And then you got to the table and you got ready to eat, but you looked down and some of the ingredients were missing. Some of the meal menus were missing. You had your meat and your potatoes, but maybe the salad wasn't on the plate yet. Have you ever felt as though there's been an interruption in things and you've been waiting and waiting and waiting? But the Bible declares that those that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. They will mount up on the wings of an eagle. They'll be running and not be weary. They'll walk and leap and they'll never faint. And so what you gotta do in the middle of the dinner, when you know everything is not added to the table yet, you gotta just sit on down at the table and put your napkin on your chest and put your napkin up under your neck and prepare yourself to eat at your table amongst the presence of your enemies. God said to prepare yourself, but the table is spread and everything is there. And there may be one or two ingredients. There may be one or two meals that are missing from the table, but they're not far behind, for I see them sitting at the buffer. Oh, my Son of God. They have what is called the hutch in the dining room. They have what is called the table. And then they have what is called the server. And I see the last ingredients of what you need in your life to get you to destiny is on the server. It's coming up. I said your order is almost up. Your order is almost there. And you got to do like Paul did and write the letter to let the people know this is what you got to do. This is what I'm going to do as I wait on God to renew everything. As I wait on God to fulfill his word, I'm going to sit back and I'm going to dine and I'm going to sit down and I'm going to eat at the table with God and I'm going to divulge in the food of the Spirit. I'm going to give me a little bit of joy and eat on that. I'm going to give me a little bit of peace and eat on that. I'm going to give me a little bit of long suffering and I'm going to eat on that. And I might as well drink a little bit of faith on the day. See, the Bible declares that faith is the substance of the things hoped for and the evidence of the things not seen. Just because you don't see it, it doesn't mean it's not on the server. Just because you don't see it, it doesn't mean that it's not on its way. Oh, my Son, when we find that Paul wrote this letter to the Romans because he could not be there, but it was his desire to go that way. And until he got there, he said, look, this is what I need you to do. I need you to stand in the blessed assurance of the hope of Jesus Christ, not conforming to the old man, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And this is what you got to do until I get there. I need you to stand on the word of God, not wavering to the left and not wavering to the right. But I said, stand thereof. When things get tougher, when things get hectic, when it feels like everything is topsy-turvy, when you feel as though you're going to lose your mind, God said to still stand and stand thereof, having yourself girded with the breastplate of righteousness, having your feet shod with the gospel. for peace. Oh, come on and help me, God. Having your lands guarded. Oh, come on and help me, God. And don't forget the helmet of salvation. Oh, Bashaka, son of God. Paul was a man that was writing this letter to the Romans. Oh, the first chapter of Romans. Paul set the tone. He set, oh, Bashaka, son of what was expected from the salvation of Jesus Christ. And he said in the very beginning of the fourth verse, don't get it twisted to declare and be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness. Paul set the tone very early. He said the Spirit of holiness, and he also said here, power. Oh, come on and help us, God, on today. You've got to have Holy Ghost power when you're waiting on God to do something in your life. See, the majority of us don't want to wait on God. But God said for us to wait. Hallelujah. This is what he told the disciples when he was going to leave. He said, sit there in Jerusalem and wait. Do you know what Jerusalem is? Jerusalem is home. Sit at home and wait because I'm going to send you something that will give you the ability and to endure the test of time. I'm going to give you the ability to endure all that you're going through. But you got to wait on my Spirit. You got to wait on my glory. And the Bible said that they were all there in Jerusalem waiting on God as he promised. And the Bible said they were in that upper room. And they were all on one accord, singing and praising God. And all of a sudden, oh, my shirt, my son. See, this is how God works. All of a sudden, the unsudden things, the unexpected things, things you don't expect to happen. All of a sudden, the Bible said that the Spirit of God went in the room and he fell upon the people. If we would just wait, oh God, God is still yet solving and settling the matter of it all. And the Bible says, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations, for his name, among whom ye are also called of Jesus Christ, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints of God. And see, what else we've got to know and understand is that when Paul wrote the book of Romans, he said to the people, beloved of God, called to be of saints, and God has called us to something on today. My question to you on today, the Holy Ghost question to you on today is, what have you been called to wait for? Oh, my son of God, we know that you've been called with a holy calling, and we know that you are there with Christ Jesus, but what has God called you to wait upon? I can imagine that the people in Rome were really anticipating the arrival of Paul. They probably were sitting on the seaside looking for the ship to sail in at any moment, saying, Paul must be on this ship. No, Paul wasn't on that ship. Then they must have said, well, the next ship is coming in, and Paul must be on this ship. No, Paul never made it. But yet, still, they got a letter. They were expecting Paul to step off the ship. But all of a sudden, the postmaster said, I have a letter for you. Is this the church in Rome? All of a sudden, the postmaster said, I have a letter for you. Is this my man or daughter? Is this my son or daughter? I want you to wait. I want you to wait on me until I get there. Oh, Bashata, son of God. And the Bible declares, Paul said, first I thank my God through Christ Jesus for you. All that your faith is spoken of throughout the word. Oh, Bashata, son of God. He said, that is that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both you and me. The next thing we've got to understand in this letter that Paul wrote to the Roman church, he said, we've got to be comforted together with you by the mutual faith of both you and me. See, what he's saying right there is, if any man touch and agree, God will do it in the spirit realm. That's what God said in his word, that if any man touch and agree, that which they shall have. And God said, where two or three are gathered together, there I will be of God in the midst. So when Paul wrote the letter to Rome, he said, the faith be comforted of both you and me. See, I need something from God, and Paul needed something from God. The preacher is not exempt from needing something from God, and you need something from God. The church needs something from God today, and Paul said, until we get it, let us be comforted in the faith of God, knowing that God is going to show up right in the nick of time. But until it gets there, we still gotta have faith. Faith is believing and hoping in something, although you don't see the manifestation in it. Oh, speak, Holy Ghost, today. Wisdom is going through the camera today. Wisdom is going through the line today. Faith is a substance of things you hope for. Faith is a thing that makes you continue to hope, although you don't see it in front of you. I need a ride to the grocery store, and I don't see a car to give me a ride, but I believe that at any moment, somebody is going to show up on the doorstep and give me that ride that I need. I need, oh, Bashatasana, a job on the day, and I don't see a job in front of me. But what you ought to tell yourself is that my job is right around the corner. Why? Because faith said it's there. If any man have a certain measure of faith, he can ask what he may and do not waver. For every man that waver is like a sea tossed to and fro. And God said, don't you think that I'll give it to you? He said, ask and I'll give it to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be open. Does anybody need God to open some doors on the day? Oh, just go ahead and have a little faith. Take it up with Jesus. Tell him all about your troubles. He'll hear your faintest cry and he'll answer by and by. Does anybody have a special need from Jesus? The people in Rome had a need. And Paul was able to send that letter to pacify them. And that's the message that God is sending on today. He's seeking to pacify the time. Oh, hallelujah, God. But God said, don't despise small beginnings. Even in the middle of it all, you can't despise where you're at. Even while you're waiting on God, you can't despise what you're doing. Oh, come on, somebody. Oh, if you're going to have fun, have fun. Don't complain about it. Don't wallow in self-pity. But pick your head up and hold and square your shoulders off. You got a cowgirl up and you got a cowboy up and say, I'm going to enjoy the ride until God shows up. And I know that I'm in my Jerusalem. I know that I'm waiting at home. See, what we got to understand is before the disciples could be sent out, they had to wait at home. And a lot of us are being waiting to be sent out by God today. A lot of us are waiting for that new door to open. And a lot of us are in our city of Jerusalem, but we gotta wait on the Holy Ghost. What did they do while they were waiting? The Bible said that they were praying and fasting, that they were seeking God. And that's what God wants you to do on today. He wants you to pray and fast and seek his face. You ought to be on the phone line calling up sister girlfriend saying, I just want to pray for you on today. I know you wait like me, girlfriend, and we're going to get through this together. And you're going to wait and I'm going to wait. And we're going to cry and we're going to pray. And we're going to pray and we're going to cry. And the man ought to be calling up they homeboys down on the block and saying, man, homie, I know you're waiting, and we're going to wait together, and we're going to suffer this thing out. God on today. God is saying that the Romans received a letter from Paul because Paul had not yet arrived. And they waited and they waited and they waited. And in that letter, they were strengthened. And this is what God is saying on today. Although you may be waiting, inside of that letter that is addressed to your Jerusalem, which is your home, you are strengthened. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you are strengthened, man and woman of God out there. And the Bible said that when the time came, oh, hallelujah, God, even though they were in that upper room, or even though they were faced with opposition, I can imagine the people were saying, what are they doing there in that upper room? They've been in there for 30 days. They've been in there a long time. They've been in there for 3 days. They've been in there waiting. What are they doing in there? Regardless of if the people talk about you and say, what are you doing waiting on the Lord? You all might as well just give up right now. He ain't coming. The people in Rome, they were waiting on Paul. And I can imagine the people said, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, y'all still having this home church. You ought to give it up. Paul is not coming. The one that is your leader, the one that you look to. But Paul said, because of the faith of you and me, he said, don't give up. And I can imagine the people on the day of Pentecost were mocking and scorning and saying, give up on God. You know he ain't coming. Why y'all up in that upper room praying and praising God? And I can imagine some of the people, while they were waiting, they got their extra dip. God wants you to get your extra dip on today. The dip in the Holy Ghost that gives you the ability to long suffer and wait on Jesus. But when the time came, the Bible said that a strong wind, somebody ought to say, my gust of wind is coming. Somebody ought to say, my wind is blowing my way. Somebody ought to prophesy to their wind and say, blow on me. Blow up my open door. All of a sudden, the doors were open and the Spirit of God shoot in on the people and it came in. And the Bible said, it sat on the people like a cloven tongue full of fire. But when God shows up, he sets the tone. When God shows up, he puts all those on fire. When God shows up, oh, Bashaka, son of God, I know that we're in the middle of the week and they were waiting for the weekend to come. And it is what they call Hump Day Wednesday. But you gotta wait for Friday evening about 5 o'clock. And in the middle of the week while you're waiting, get your Bible, read your Bible. While you're waiting, get on your knees and pray. While you're waiting, get in a secret place with God. Because God looks to settle the matter of it all. And while you're in the middle of the storm of your life, wait on God. He's there with you. He's going to renew you. He will give you the wings of an eagle. You will run and not be weary. You will walk and never faint. They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. And the Bible said that Paul told the people that we're going to use your faith and we're going to use my faith. He said, I would not have you ignorant that oftentimes I purpose to come unto you or not, but oh, I shall pass son of God, that you might have some fruit among you, even as amongst the Gentiles. And the next thing you got to understand is manifest through some fruit while you wait. Don't just sit around and click the television and the remote control and see what's on this and what's on that. You know the shows that are out there. Oh, Bashaka, son of God. Mari Povich, hallelujah, God. You know the shows that are out there. Queen Latifah and Ellen DeGeneres. You know the shows that are out there. Oh, all of the daytime operas. Oh, get you some fruit while you're waiting. Me manifest you something that shows that you are following Christ Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Get on the service board. Be a missionary somewhere. Go out and evangelize to some people. Get you some fruit, something that can be eaten of. Something that shows that you are a true man or woman of God out there. Oh, the Bible says that when we go down into the grave, we cannot work no more. Why? Because there's darkness there. And so God said to manifest for fruit. For everything that is not of fruit is hewn down from the fire. It's thrown into the fire and it's hewn down. And we find here that Paul said, oh, so as much as in me, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also. And you gotta be ready. Ready in due season. You gotta be ready instant in the season and ready out of the season. Paul said, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also. I know you gotta make this letter work for you on my behalf, but while you're waiting, I'm ready to preach also. And you gotta sing it inside of your belly. Be ready to sing. I know you may not be on America's Idol, but get in front of you a mirror and start singing. Blow your lungs out. You gotta get ready. Paul said, I'm ready to preach. Oh, I shall cast sound of God. I know you may not have that truck driving company yet, but until you get it, act as though you're the president now and get yourself ready. I know you may not be in the position right now, but wear your physician's jacket and get yourself ready. You gotta get positioned. You gotta get yourself in a place where you're ready. So when God say to move, you're like the children of Israel in the sea. They didn't even have time to put yeast in the bread. Why? Because that was ready. Oh, those that get ready. God said, get ready. Pack your stuff up and put it by the door. I know you don't have the moving company truck yet. I know you don't have the U-Haul yet. But pack up and get ready. Oh, because you're going on up. See, you gotta get ready and you gotta be ready. Paul said, I'm ready to preach to you in Rome also. I may not make it to Rome right now, but I'm still getting ready. And the Bible said, inside of Romans, I feel all right, y'all. Because you ought to be getting ready out there. Getting ready for God to do something great in your life. Getting ready for the miracle of God to happen. Getting ready for your healing. Getting ready for your deliverance. Getting ready for your breakthrough. Getting ready, getting ready, getting ready. It's already around the corner. And the Bible said, for then as they have the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness and ungodliness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For have God has shown it to them, for if the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. What does that say on today? That's Romans chapter 1, the 18th verse through the 21st verse. Through the 20th verse, the Bible says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. What is God saying there? God is saying that everything that you are standing in, I'm made. Every place that you go, God said, I'm making. God is saying, everything that you're desiring in your life, I make it happen. God is saying that man can do nothing without me. God said, I reign upon the just and the unjust. God told Nebuchadnezzar, I rule amongst the kingdom of men. Everything that you're waiting for today, it is because God is able to do it. Meaning that the sand that you're standing on and the road that you're standing
God. It's only there because God made it. It means that the trees that you breathe in for oxygen, they're only there because God made the trees. It means that the breath that you're taking is only there because God made the breath in man. For he breathed inside of Adam, and Adam became a living soul. Therefore, you have no choice but to wait on God. Therefore, you have no choice but to trust in God. Therefore, you have no choice but to do it. God has settled the manner of it all. Thou shalt wait upon God, on the true and living King, and he will manifest himself. I'm getting ready to close. We're in Romans, the first chapter. We're going through the teaching series. What is God saying to our lives on a day? The Bible said in verse 23, and change the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. And there goes that word, amen. Oh, Bashata, Son of God, has settled the matter of it all. For at the end of this scripture, we read, amen. Meaning that you ought to worship and honor God on the day. Don't worship the creature. Don't worship yourself. Don't worship that man. Don't worship that woman. But worship God on the day. Worship the Creator, because he is the potter and you are the clay. And God wants to mold you. Mold of God into the image you want them to be. Oh, God said, I'm going to mold you. God said, I'm going to make you over. I'm going to shake you up, and then I'm going to turn you loose. But first, I got to set things up. I got to get them in order. It's like this. When you go through Burger King, first you got to place your order. But before you place your order, you got to decide what you want. Do you want to have it your way? Or do you want to have it the way the Holy Ghost say have it? Or do you want to do your own thing? See, when you get it your own way, you may get it any old type of way. But when you go back through the line again, it may not be available because they may have changed the menu. And God is saying on today, I know you want it like Burger King. And I know you want to have it your way. But you got to have it the way the Holy Ghost say have it. And you got to worship me in the process while I make you over, while I set up your buffet, while I make things right for you. Because when I give it to you, when you go back to Burger King, they will not have changed the menu. Everything you ordered before is going to be there. Every blessing you called upon is going to be there. Everything you called upon is going to be there. When God heals the body, it never comes back again. Oh, somebody ought to say, when God heals me, it don't show up the second time. Somebody ought to say, when God heal me, there's no such thing as remission. What is remission? Oh, that's not the spirit of God. But the Bible said the spirit of infirmity was on the woman. It was on the man. And she stood up straightway. Straightway she straightened her back. There was no remission. There wasn't anything lurking, hiding in the shadows. No, oh, we didn't get it all. Oh, come on and help me go out on today. There is no such thing as a second opinion. When you go through the healing of God, God does it right the first time. God's going to do it right the first time. When God bless you with that job, he's going to send you another job, a job that's better. Oh, come on and help me, God. God is always taking us from level to level, from faith to faith, from joy to joy, from peace to peace, from happiness to happiness, from love to love, from understanding to understanding, from anointing to anointing. Hallelujah, God. God's spirit is perfect. And inside of his spirit is found perfection. Hey, listen, the message is very clear on today. Wait on God. God has sent you a letter in the mail. Oh, Bashatasane, and it is a spiritual letter. A letter that says, wait, because I'm coming. Just like God used Paul to send a letter to the Romans. Who do you think decided to to write to the Romans. The Bible said that every word in the Bible is inspired of God. God gave Paul the inspiration to write to the Romans and to let them know, I'm not there yet, but here is something that I'm leaving with you and I'm sending to you to let you know that you are not alone. When the disciples went to Jerusalem and they went in the upper room and they waited on God, they were not alone, for God was yet still on the way. And what were they doing while they were waiting? They were singing and praising and praying to God. And this is what God is saying on today. While you're in the middle of the buffet table, and everything may not be laid out on the table, you may be missing a certain ingredient. You may be missing your drink, or you may be missing your appetizer. One thing you have to know is that I am still yet there. And the message is very clear on today. While you are waiting, get you some fruit. While you are waiting, get you something that shows that I am waiting on God. Don't get you nothing that shows that I'm waiting on man, but that I'm waiting on God, because God is yet still able to perform that which he promised. The message is very clear on today. Listen, I have a book called 30 Days of Dreams and Visions. Excuse me, and you can get this book on Amazon.com. The book is available. Amen. 30 Days of Dreams and Visions. And in this book, God tells the people, amen, what he desires from them. And God tells the people how they can be encouraged. God knows the situation that you're going through, and he knows what you're faced with. Get the book, 30 Days of Dreams and Visions, available on Amazon.com. You can get the book there, 30 Days of Dreams and Visions. Or you can go to the website, AlyssaNarvez.com. I've been your host, Pastor Alyssa Narvez. And remember that you have to get you some fruit while you're waiting on God. To wait on God, because he will renew you and he will strengthen you. In due time, you will reap if you faint not. And remember that God is still yet writing your story of your life, and he's fulfilling the pages even as we speak. And God has settled the matter of it all. And I'll see you the next time. May the grace of God be with you, and God bless you richly. Bye-bye.